So I really don't know what is about to happen now. And it's a kind of a great feeling. It's the first interactive session at Sigsys that I remember. I mean, we've had a lot of audience participation, but this is different and exciting. So that's the introduction. This is Daniela.
Great introduction. Wow. Right. I know. Start off strong. Wow. Okay. So thank you all for joining us. We're calling this project Making Core Memory in many ways because that is, in some senses, what we will be doing today. With me are the fabulous Samantha Shorey and Rose Paquet Kinsley, two PhD students also working on this project, University of Washington. I'm Daniela Rosner, assistant professor in the Department of Human-Centered Design. And I'm going to introduce you to a project that we did in collaboration with two other colleagues that you'll see in a moment. So this project is using a moment in engineering history to re-examine craft work's intellectual contribution to innovation work. But this is kind of a two-part mission. So it's about how craft work becomes hardware manufacturing, but also how hardware manufacturing becomes craft work. So throughout the first two decades of the Cold War, magnetic core memory was that principal mechanism by which computers stored and retrieved information. The computers for the Apollo mission stored information, these core memory ropes, these wires that were threaded through or around magnetized metal rings. And the NASA engineers nicknamed this hardware LOL memory. Why? Well, it was for the little old ladies, in quotes, who carefully wove wires around the electromagnetic ferrite cores by hand. And the code, which was written by the trailblazing Margaret Hamilton, was made material by this team of women outside Boston. So today we are drawing on traditions of participatory inquiry to examine these histories and knowledges of weaving. It's undergirding the Apollo mission and many others. And I'm interested in this personally because I think it's a nice project to encapsulate a vision of what I'm calling critical fabulation. So this approach to imagine differently through interventionist inquiry what kinds of worlds we want to live in. And this comes out of some work in feminist science studies, philosophers Vinciana Desprez and Donna Haraway, who discuss fabulations as sites of becoming differently. Desprez writes, to create stories, to make history, is to reconstruct, to fabulate in a way that opens other possibilities for the past and in the present and the future. And this is out of her text, her recent text, What Would Animals Say If We Ask the Right Questions? So quite a different context, but one that I think really builds a nice bridge to today's forms of inquiry into and as design. So these critical fabulations are kind of tracing these pertinent histories in interesting ways that open opportunities for shaping the world in responsive and responsible ways. And this is something we're interested in this project. So we're taking up techniques of design, of many ways feminist technoscience to develop this collaborative quilt made up of core memory patches that materializes aspects of the work that Hamilton and the core memory weavers did. So you're going to receive a patch kit, and I will show you the quilt that's now on the wall to your left has several tiles of magnetic core memory, a couple. Yes, exactly. Thank you, Rose. These are from the DEC computer, circa 1964. They are also interestingly woven into patches that a woman who I'll introduce you to in a moment, a master quilter, created with a similar technique on the corners. And then will be, again, included with patches you will create in a moment. So each core module is adding up to 125 characters of data, which is almost one tweet. And so once you create these boards with loom strings and beads in place of the ferrite core and wire, then you will snap them to the quilt and connect to a central microcontroller that's driving an archive of media that we collected. And that will send the tweet of that's based on the media that you will hear as you press on your tile. So we'll see if that works. A lot to say. With this project, we are exploring contributions of this embodied gendered forms of knowledge that allow innovators to imagine new ways of making, of remembering, performing engineering histories. So as these critical fabulations, we're using craft as a line of inquiry with its intersections in theory and practice, and its interesting ways of working activism, understanding, intervention, and insight together. So our intention is not only to bring the work of these LOL weavers back into histories of innovation, but also use these processional histories to imagine our relationships to technology afresh. So how we might live and be alongside technological developments that are complete with their ongoing knots and possibilities and troubles. So in a moment, I will ask Sam and Rose to reflect on their experience thinking about core memory and this project. And I will first introduce you to a few instrumental collaborators who are not here today. This is Helen. Oh. This is Helen Remick, a master quilter who works with obsolescent technology. So she's worked with film, old film strips, slides, CDs, but began by working with fabric. Let's see if it works.
Woo. Approach to developing something new. And then one gets a lovely interdisciplinary approach to developing something new. This is a project of that kind. I brought to it skills in putting together fabric to hold things together. I loved the developing the ideas to making a macro chip out of fabric, learning all kinds of new skills, always changing things, developing as we went along, lots of skills. I would do it again in a minute. I hope I will.
Great. And here is Brock, who is a technology enthusiast, but most critically interested in display technology from the last 60 years. He has an incredible archive of this, and he's also a lecturer in HCDE.
What else can you say? That you can store memory in a piece of ferrite and then recall it is kind of incredible, and the amount of labor that it took to actually make them is astonishing. So that's super cool. I'm interested in all kinds of old technologies.
And what drew you to the quilt?
The quilt, I got drawn to the quilt because I'm engaged in anything that has to do with sort of the history of technology and textiles and memory. So the idea of working on a project that kind of encompasses all of those was super exciting to me.
So. Perfect. So now I'll ask Sam to come up, and we'll continue to introduce the patch kits after they speak.
Hi, I'm Sam, and I am a PhD candidate in the Department of Communication at the University of Washington. And as a communication scholar, I'm really interested in how discourses, representation, and especially histories help us to rethink what we think of as technological in the present. And I think that core memory is a really interesting place where we can push on these ideas. The Apollo 8 required the work of over 400,000 people. That's a fact that we often overlook in our tendency to valorize individuals, which obscures the social and the collaborative practices that make designing and producing technology possible. Beyond the really wonderful engineers like Margaret Hamilton, there are the women who physically built moon machines. And far from being merely hired hands, these women's gendered expertise and embodied dexterity were absolutely essential to core memory and the success of the Apollo mission. In foregrounding the work of the little old ladies, we begin to see an alternate history of science beyond the brave astronauts and brilliant scientists. Rather, we see the collaborative, routine handwork that is often overlooked and also framed as completely antithetical to technology and modernity in broad terms. So the contemporary conversation around the maker movement has attempted to recenter material knowledge and rewrite material histories into innovation. But these interventions remain squarely situated in images of boys with toys, reinforcing our cultural imaginaries about not only who makes technology, but how one makes technology. Highlighting the women makers who made core memory, we build new understandings of machine making beyond the engineers and the men turning bolts on our factory floors. And this is Rose.
Hi, so briefly, I will just say that I came to this project with over 10 years of museum work experience, both as a practitioner, but also as a scholar, and one might say a provocateur. And I am particularly interested in how we activate and we enlist artifacts in museum galleries to tell certain stories. And what particularly draws my attention is how certain stories tend to be foregrounded and made visible while others are made silent, to be silent or invisible, which is the case for this example of core memory, which might be inserted within a chronological narrative of the evolution of computer memory that celebrates engineering and computational progress, computing progress, but does not make clear the intricate labor that went into producing them. And yes, so that's what draws me to this project and what I find very interesting about it. And I hope that today you'll get to explore some of these histories with us.
So, in your patch kit, what do you find? You're going to find some pieces of thread, a board that looks or will become your loom, and a needle that is made of plastic for your writing convenience, and and safety. That is all connected, that's right, around beads that are your ferrite core. Some of you actually will have ferrite core. A bonus. And if you do, you should be creative in thinking about how to use that in this experiment. So we are going to start by walking you through the process of weaving a ferrite core board like those that are up on our quilt. Do you want to help me do this?
Yeah.
Great. So number one, let's align your board. How does that look? Sam's gonna demonstrate. The two magnets should be at the very top.
And you'll wanna unclip the thread. The thread is already attached for you. So go ahead and unclip that and let that unfurl.
Great. So now you're gonna find the light string. You'll each have some variation in what that light string looks like. Hopefully it's white. But it might not be. Yes, the
light brown.
Light or light brown. Find that one and thread your needle. That I don't give instructions for. That's right, you can undo. But that.
Oh, that isn't.
Because that loop you are going to use in a moment. But why don't you not let that spill, so hold on to those beads. That's gonna be part of the challenge here.
Yeah,
see,
oh yeah, I was the production line on this one. And the makerspace, they did it. Well, I did four of them.
And as you do that, I don't want to go too fast, but you're going to tie the light string. Oh, good, it's tied. I put that in the instructions just in case yours fell off. So thread the needle, and eventually you will put four beads, just four, onto that needle. You're gonna take your light string, thread that string through the needle, and put four beads.
So some of you may not be familiar with how to thread a needle, so you'll pull a couple inches out, and you don't wanna tie it off, because then it won't go through the beads. And so, if you did tie it off, it's all right, it's easy to undo, but you're just gonna let a little bit hang out, but to keep it there, no need for any knots at this time.
And I did bring scissors through security if you need to chop one off.
Yeah, you can take those off.
And the beads come off the thing.
That's right. You're going to have to undo the loop. Yes. Who wouldn't be careful? There are going to be mistakes, and that is part of our joy of this process. Okay, so you're welcome to continue on to the next step if you have threaded your beads, which is to move across the loom so that you make a horizontal line and thread the needle through the hole that is exactly horizontal. So that would be third, if you're aligned like this image, it would be the top left hole, but on the left side. From the bottom to the top works.
We're doing horizontal.
Oh, we are.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Never mind. Yeah. Oh, you started. Oh, gotcha. So you can just go the opposite direction if your tie is that way. Yeah. So you will be going horizontal and tying. I think everyone is opposite. That's cool. This is yours. Okay, and now once you have one horizontal line, you make another. So you're going to go thread the needle down through the next hole and below. So the if you think about the loom as two columns on the left and the right side, you're going down, yep, going into that next hole and then around and threading four more beads. Conveniently, we have a dark floor, so if you lose your beads, you will need to do some searching. Okay, so following again this pattern, this is what you should be building right now. The image is much more helpful, I hope. So this is the easy part. You're the first. Yeah.
Thank you.
Wow, some of you have skills. Okay, and if when you get to the end, make a knot. And if you're a perfectionist, we have scissors, you can cut it off. Make a knot, just like the one at the top, exactly. Any kind of knot that keeps it there. Oh, great question. You want to pull extremely tight, so tight that you almost think the knot will come off. Yes, all of the threads need to be taut as much as possible. So as you're doing this, I want you to think a little bit about the scale you are doing it at, because The scale you will look at in a moment when you come over to this quilt is orders of magnitude smaller. And the precision necessary of this, they had different tools, they had different mechanisms. Along the way, there were even an array of tools built just for this process, which we have records of, patents that we can share with you.
Yeah, that's why I thought they built an actual machine.
Exactly. And eventually, it was automated. Yep. So we're at the early stages of tracing that history at this point. But here, you are just making the first... The first attempts at getting it there. Okay, great. Wonderful. We have a pair of scissors.
Oh!
Who
wants scissors?
Okay. So when you are done tying your knot, you can cut that off. Yes, you are going to thread your number two, the darker of the two threads. It does. So, when you go through, this is the most difficult part, so I'm going to repeat it several times. When you start threading the needle, what you need to think about is the direction that you are threading through the bead. So you'll be threading from right to left, and then left to right, right to left to right, so that the bead itself is going to orient differently toward that thread. So you will, as a preview, you will be creating this matrix. Do you notice how the orientation of the bead is orthogonal, right? So sometimes it's facing down right, sometimes up left. So you will need to alternate the direction that you are threading through the bead. Very quiet.
We're really concentrating.
Yes.
So this is one of the most interesting parts of this process. So there are several aspects that we found interesting, but one is how little documentation we can find, and even recollection of the people who were physically present for this weaving process and around it, of the labor. There is a major gap right now in actually understanding much of what we are doing in this room.
I want to see the archives on the Chinese version.
Oh,
I have photographs of the Chinese labor force for the conference.
Oh, I would love to see that.
So what did you say? 16 cores here, and there were.
Yeah. So we've seen the video.
16,000.
That is.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
I'm making progress.
I spent most of the time putting the bead back on the string.
Yeah.
That's where I'm at.
Yeah.
I feel like it's It's like when people tell you like the best part, like getting out of debt, like they feel so good that they've gotten to zero. Like that's where I'm at. Like I was dead when we
did that. Sort of
that's
the
worst.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
sorry.
Do
we
we're making progress.
Another interesting facet of this project is thinking about this terminology, right? How do we talk about the process that you were working through? And the fact that we came at it actually as a weaving process was really strange to many of the people building Core Memory at the time, engineers that we've been in contact with. They said things like, I've never called it weaving. It makes sense that it would be, that's something you would call it. That thread was used in a lot of the text, the term thread for the wires that are in place of the strings you're using right now. But that it was... That you would call it weaving, even though that was sort of our entry into the project, is thinking about this as a clearly warp and a weft, right? So the operators were the weavers were building Core Memory. The terminology. Yeah, the work itself.
I talk a lot about passing.
Okay. Threading was used. Yeah. But not weaving. Yeah.
Another thing we really liked is there was not a lot of information, but there's been a little bit of secondhand buzz around the story on the internet, and a viral video website called Size Stories, which does like little tidbits about weaving. A man did a video about this, and he used the words weaving and sewing interchangeably.
And knitting.
And it resulted in the comment section being from all these fiber artists being like, we appreciated this history in this video, but these are completely different processes.
Yes,
we love that.
Yeah, knitting and weaving is the same. Weaving man.
So each one of these could be a magnetized or unmagnetized state without achieving.
That's right. So depending, you have right now, the wires that would be writing, and the sensing wire, the reading wire, is your last step. It is next. I don't know how people are doing. If you are moving ahead quickly, you can also turn to your packet. Yes. In fact, I can show you a picture of one of the microscopes.
Well done.
That's right. We've been talking with folks at IBM, actually, that have recollections of the machine.
We have photographs.
Do you? That would be terrific. Ah, can we visit it?
Should we tie off?
Yes. So if you are done with your weft, do tie it. And we are using weaving terms in our...
I tried really hard there.
Right. I know, that was impressive.
Oh, yeah.
The sensing wire, the diagonal wire, we'll still call it wire. That is the green. And that is the most fun. You can kind of improv when you get there, which I know you're dying to do.
Oh, cool.
Rapid frameworks that use this exact same system, including work with diagonal.
Oh, yeah.
For basically the expression of characters on the screen.
Yeah, actually, where's
but also where that is.
So
it is the character expressed on the screen, but it's also the way in which you would encode the character for its expression. And somehow, I've seen this exact diagram pattern before, but imagine instead of 4x4, like 25x25, it's a dot matrix, and then you hear it by activating
Yeah.
Assuming I'm doing this, I love this.
You are going to go through a very different process. Now you're going to look at the orientation of the beads and follow that as you weave back and forth. So that means skipping every other row. You're going to go through the beads from the one of the corners. You can choose which. This is more improv. You now curve around to the skipping one row. If we're thinking about rows now diagonally rather than orthogonal up and down, and you'll follow the perfect alignment of beads that you created. No mistakes. No holes of the board now. We're just going for beads. You just go. Yeah.
So that means the original bead, the corner bead, should have had that orientation. I accidentally had another orientation.
Yeah. Well, you can start in the other direction.
You're not alone.
Is that happening? Yeah. No, they're all, I screwed up every single, like this one is going this way.
Yeah.
So there's no way.
Should be touching every bead by the end, and when you're in an awkward position and realize that, you know, the beads that you haven't touched are on the opposite end, you can either cut and restart or just take your wire around to that end. They often stopped and started. You can look at with a magnifying glass some of these cores and see the wires kind of chopped off at one end and then a new one started. So the only snags you'll run into is if your beads were not perfectly aligned. Which would never happen. Let's see. Again, if you pulled all of your threads taut in the beginning, if you want to re-knot and do that, that's an option.
And if you made a mistake, we do need to start. So this was actually a process we read about.
The correcting of mistakes. If you imagine again that what you are doing right now is about a few millimeters in size on the boards, this. If there was a mistake in a board the size of the ones that are up there on the wall, to redo this wiring is quite a mess.
You tell me.
How are you going to fix a mistake?
Iterate.
Yes.
You did it. Beautiful.
I don't think my space men are making it back. They're going to be up there for a long time.
Or you can
no guidance.
Maybe they didn't actually take off. Yeah,
that's true. Maybe they just got grounded.
You're intending to kill them off, I see.
Yeah, if you'd like to see a sample, Morgan has a nice one. And there's a couple, there's one up here as well. Two.
Did you consult the book called Memories of the Industry by Hughes?
Yeah.
There's a bunch of stuff there about cars.
Yeah.
They go so far as to
be. Yeah, actually, are in touch with them as well. Yeah. So, I wanted any detail on that.
With our master quilter and thinking, oh, which of these would have been the sense line? So many experts, and then we found a tiny little passage in there where they thought, first you would load 4B
right
onto the line,
right?
Onto
that piece. But it's more of it's kind of a very different experience to start to work at learning this through the material. And actually doing that before talking with folks was really interesting because that became an entry point to thinking about how some of the innovations in this technology.
Right, what that these cars have.
Right.
Yeah.
So this, I want everyone to take a look at the corner pieces in the quilt that this one is down, is a piece of foam core and some wires that Colin Remick recreated for us. And this is now, again, at a scale much, much larger than the cores on the quilt, but incredible amount of handwork went into that.
And she compared that one to embroidery to get even another type of fiber arts involved. we call those her embroidery patches.
Okay, so you should be here, which is at the right stage for creating the switch that we are going to make that connects your patch to the quilt. So, is anyone ready for our next stage? Just a couple. I'll keep it here for a second.
Are you starting from the top of the house line?
What can you do with all the extra green?
You can just tie it off and cut it off.
Can we skip over?
Did you restart?
Oh, yeah.
But these are the next time around.
Wow, look at how perfect the squares are. I'm amazed.
Oh, thank you.
I'm just looking at your phone going like, why am I so slow?
No.
Considered.
Let's say I wanted to be everything on that except for the type of
where's those scissors? All of the line.
Oh, so you start.
There's a pair of here.
Every other line.
Like
Some sort of combination.
After getting the green sense line put together, Daniela will walk us through that.
Great. So we're going to find the diamond-shaped or square felt piece. And you want to orient that like a diamond, so the tips are up and down. And then you'll find two copper foil pieces. They look like strips of copper with sticky tape backing on them, white backing. And you're gonna weave those two pieces. This is your last weaving, all very sad. They're fairly straightforward to weave. If you look at the slits in the felt, you'll see that there are two that are aligned in one direction and two aligned in the opposite. And the key here is that you want that white to be on top, and you want the copper showing on the bottom. So depending on how you hold it, right, doesn't matter, you're gonna get the same image that you see here in the slides.
So the content of the copper will be only
the exactly. So the idea is there's a circle in the middle and the contact will happen right in that circle. So you're creating a little push button where if you push the two together, you'll connect the two copper pieces, but otherwise they're separated by the space, that thickness of the felt. So you just made a button. Very cool. Not part of the original process. We're creating a little circuit here.
so you can connect to the quilt.
Like
okay, once you have that, it gets a little bit tricky because, oops, here we go. What you're going to do is now attach the foil to your loom, your patch, and you're going to need to take off some of the sticky tacky tape, but carefully. So first, I would recommend taking off the ends. So the top two ends, you want to make sure, this is the most important part, the top two ends need to touch your the circles on the magnet at the top of your loom. So the magnetic circles. That's right, that is the tricky part. You need to turn under. Yeah, so one way to do that would just be to move it up a little bit and curve it under as you stick it. I'm trying to gesture, but it's very hard. Fold under the end of the copper tape here. So you can see in that upper right corner, that's where you're folding under the copper tape. So again, remove the white backing just at the ends, and then you're going to fold under the end of the copper tape on the one on the strip of copper with the white facing up. Most importantly, keep the contact between the copper and the magnets. So what the reason why we're using copper tape is because it's an easy mechanism for playing with electronics. And here, actually, this copper tape has adhesive that's also conductive. So the adhesive, the other side of the tape, will continue to carry current.
Yeah, and so it can go either over or under, because at that point, you basically
got it.
It's so tight that all the wires are.
Yeah. If you were one of the lucky people to get a core, you can think about your core at this point as well. You can put it onto the copper. Would that do anything? Maybe. Probably not. You can put it onto the string as a feature. In a future version, we're going to make the core actually work as part of this, but this is our early, early patch kit. Okay, so when you are, yeah, exactly. So the other end, the bottom end of the copper tape, you can attach the board just so it's secure. And what you should see is that the diamond should be in the center now of your square.
So now we have an exciting feature. When you guys plug in, when you all plug in your patch kits, two things will happen. You will complete the circuit on the quilt, and it will trigger an audio clip that is taken from a first-person account about the core memory weaving. So some of the clips are from various documentaries that have featured a little tiny bit about core memory weaving. Some of them are from the Apollo Guidance Computer History Conference hosted by David Mindel in the early 2000s and from other various media sources. And the second thing will happen is that it will trigger a tweet to go out on @LOLWeavers because the patches are equal in storage to about a tweet. And so your kit will also trigger the tweet.
What, can you make a note about the white?
And like any piece of technology, it is not perfect. And so the ones with the little bit of white ties at the top two corners, those are the ones with the perfected audio. So you'll want to pick one of those so you can hear the history that is attached to it. It's the little one that's facing at you. You did it!
I've all got them going the right way.
I know, it's working. It's working. My heart picked up about five, but I don't think. Yeah. Thank you.
I also want to point out before everyone breaks that the quilt, which we collaborated with Helen Remick on building, she sewed conductive thread along the front and in the middle of the quilt, which is why you are hearing any audio when it does work. Each of the wires are in fact threads, and that we're purposely using a quilting mode to think about the production of these as quilting materials. So the only wires you see are the ones at the very top next to the Arduino.